Welcome to Radio Paul's Radio Rants, broadcasting to you on Cox Channel 37, Comcast 27 in Reston, and around the world at fcac.org/radiofairfax. This is a weekly show that provides you the very best in alternative news and views with your host, Radio Paul.
You know I ain't no clown, 'cause these damn blue-collar tweakers, they're the backbone of this town.
Hey-ya, hey-ya, hey-ya.
Tonight's guest is the former president of Scientology's Narconon Arrowhead. There are a few here on Tigyak, Earth, that can speak with the authority of this architect of a program that claims it can cure drug addicts by having them speak to ashtrays and spending up to 8 hours a day in a sauna. Having lost friends and his wife for questioning the writings of L. Ron Hubbard, he wears his disconnection as a badge of honor and is now blowing the whistle on his former bosses and their abusive program. Welcome to Radio Paul's Radio Rants, Lucas Catton.
Hey, thank you, Paul. Good to be here.
I'm glad to have you. And I just guess we should get right off the bat here. What is wrong with Narconon?
Oh, boy, that's a wide open question. I mean, essentially, it is not what it portrays itself to be. And that's the biggest thing, is that it wants to be considered legitimate. It wants to try and play in the field of legitimate treatment centers, but yet it is stuck only in the design of L. Ron Hubbard and his teachings, and the two don't mix. And so to claim that it does and be something that it's not, just frankly, is not okay, let alone the dangerous aspects of it. That's just the main thing, is it's not what it claims to be.
And at one point you were a believer in Narconon, and you know, were you a Scientologist before, or did you become a Scientologist after you got Narconon?
I had been introduced to Scientology. I didn't really start being active in it whatsoever until after I went to Narconon, but it had been shown to me. Somebody tried to, start to do some Scientology auditing and possibly read some books, but basically I wasn't having any of it. And after I got into some trouble and was sent out to Narconon, then after that is when I really became a Scientologist.
And what happened where you started to see problems? What types of things were you going through that made you question what was going on? And why did you ultimately wind up leaving?
Well, it was certainly a multi-year process, basically. But I went from a diehard member. I mean, I was involved for more than a decade. 12 years I was involved in Scientology and Narconon. And it was my contributions, my faith in it, so to speak, continued to strengthen throughout the years, up until the point really where I was living in Clearwater near Flag, one of the largest concentrations of Scientologists in the world. And I started to have such intense financial pressure and from people demanding extremely large sums of money. And it started to mount. I started to get frustrated. And then I started catching people in lies as they were coming after me for more and more money, and would say that, this place was busy when I had just been there and it wasn't, or trying to say that somebody needed books donated, like a Narconon Center, for example, that the staff needed Scientology books donated to it, when I had just spoken to the director of that center the week before and said, we have 16 copies of these things that keep showing up and we need to give them away to somebody. We don't need them. But yet they continue hounding people for money. So that was the beginning, really, for me, of going, hey, something's not right here.
You had a great story about, was it the Colorado org? Somebody was trying to raise money and you said you had just been there and saw that there was nobody in the building. What was that about?
Yeah, it was Dallas, actually. Yeah. After I had quit working for Narconon, I was still a field representative for them. And my ex-wife had begun working with Narconon East US at the time. And so each year, Narconon has something called an executive directors conference that they hold in different cities throughout the world. That particular year, it happened to be in Dallas. And Scientology pushes this campaign right now called the Ideal Org, short for organization, Ideal Org campaign, where they buy, you know, spend millions of dollars for a building, then spend millions more to renovate it and claim that that's going to be the savior for that city. And their internal propaganda campaigns show, you know, lots of people there, but it's kind of all staff and all the same people. They even bus people in from different places. And so this woman called me up and was seeking $50,000 from me. I had already built up a portion of that, roughly half of it over the years, and she wanted another $25,000 from me and said, oh, you know, the Ideal Org campaign is fantastic. You know, I just spoke to the director in Dallas, and she said it's booming. It's busier than ever before. And I said, well, you know what? That's a lie. I was just there last week. It's empty. There's still plastic on the chairs. Half the building, the lights are out. It's not even in use. It's a lie. And that really started to get me to look at even more again after that.
And there was a big moment where you got lied to, or you were asked to lie at an IAS event. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, yeah. What it is is all these, there are multiple events that are held in Scientology every year. One of them is the International Association of Scientologists event that's held in October in England. And each year when they're doing these different events, the people who put on the events for the church do what they call data request gathering. And so you have to present information of what made you so fantastic that year. And you are not allowed to show anything, what they call downstat, anything that is not as high as the previous year's statistic. So they were doing lots of event data requests and looking for something. And I had been elected to the executive board over the Oklahoma Substance Abuse Services Alliance, and I was like the vice president. And essentially, somebody in the event data request unit took a picture of me and superimposed a logo from this organization and put it in their magazine and put it in their event video, where the president then, Heber Gentz of Church of Scientology, showed this picture and was supposed to be me speaking at this giant conference for this organization, but yet it was a doctored image that they made up to lie to show to their parishioners, which I was never standing in that place at that time. So it was fake. And I was like, wait a second, that's not the image that I sent.
Yeah.
So that was another big tip that, you know, that again, it's not what they're portraying it to be.
And you also, as I understand it, there's still literature out there with your name and image on it that they're using as promotions. Is that correct?
Yeah. Actually, there was, you know, one of the things that I did when I was president of Arrowhead and worked in different capacities there is I did a lot of article writing and press release and things like that. And so there are a ton of pages still on stopaddiction.com, for example, and even Narconon.org, Narconon International's website, and Narconon-news.org, where they still have press releases that included me from different events or things that I had written or that quoted me. So they haven't gone through and fully purged all of their sites yet.
I guess you can't be that suppressive of a person if they still have that stuff out there. I want to talk about some of the players. All right, there's this guy that works at Narconon Arrowhead, which has an extremely checkered past. And everybody knows who Gary Smith is, but there's a guy by the name of William Kent McGregor. And he was sued in the 1980s for sexually assaulting a patient under his care. And then he went on to slander her. And then he had a $1 million judgment against him. And to my understanding is he blew off the case. It was no big deal to him. And I have to ask, if I was in charge of Narconon, I wouldn't let this guy anywhere near the property. But you had indicated that not only is he allowed on the property, Scientology is fully aware and Narconon's fully aware of his checkered past. And I was wondering if you could tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, they're absolutely fully aware of it. In fact, it had been It had been communicated to me when I didn't know, when I first met Kent, I didn't know of the past and the situation. He was just, he and his wife, Yetta, were just coming back from Denmark at the time. And, you know, then it was made aware to me. And then I wound up seeing it actually on a website that was critical of Narconon that talked about it. It was the first time that I saw it. And then I spoke with somebody afterwards and they were totally aware of it. And he's been an integral part of the field representative team for Narconon Arrowhead for several years now, minimally. And before that, he's worked with, he did some consulting work with Narconon of Georgia. He did some work with Narconon Vista Bay. He was involved as a CARF surveyor. That's how he first got involved with Narconon, through the accreditation group when he came out to Narconon Chilaco, Oklahoma, back in, I believe, 1991.
And Gary Smith is fully aware of his background with the sexual assault and defamation and all this.
Yes, absolutely.
And Gary Smith allows him on the property.
Absolutely.
And I also understand that he has a history of ripping off people that he works with. In fact, I understand he ripped off Mary Reiser for about $5,000. Is that accurate to your knowledge?
Yeah, when she was first trying to become incorporated in the state of Georgia, she had actually hired him as being her clinical director. And she had paid him a $5,000 consulting fee or somewhere about that, possibly a little bit more. And when she went through, she was not aware of his prior court case, apparently. And he came through and started doing some meetings with some state officials. And one of the state officials actually contacted Mary and said, look, there's no way you're going to get your application approved with this guy as your clinical director. And so she was then made aware of his past at that point, had to essentially fire him, even though he had only begun working for her, but he refused to return the money that she had prepaid him for his services that he never rendered.
And as I understand it, that's actually not uncommon for him. There have been other examples of him having issues where he owes people money and he hasn't paid them. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah. And typically, and I certainly don't want to harp on one person individually, but you know, I at one point was working with Kent as well. And, you know, I had a similar experience where I was about to have a baby and was doing most of the work. And he said, look, you know, as soon as the baby comes, you can take a couple months off and I'll repay you for all the work that you've done. And it didn't happen. In fact, I was losing money at the time. And so I had to split the partnership right then and there after basically a few weeks, because it just, I could tell that he was only out for himself and wasn't going to repay that. Narconon Vista Bay out in Northern California refused to continue working with him. Narconon Georgia refused to continue working with him. Novus Detox, he was hired to consult and do a licensing setup when Novus Detox down in Florida was first opening up, and they failed the inspection based on the paperwork that he had submitted. And he thought that they were going to sue him. He actually told me, he said, I was afraid that Steve was the founder, one of the founders of Novus Detox. He said, I was afraid Steve was going to sue me. He said, they gave him, you know, $5,000 up front, and they were supposed to give him another $5,000 after they got their certification, and they wound up having to let him go and go through the certification process themselves. So there's many different people, even within their own internal network, that won't deal with him anymore.
And yet he's still allowed on the property. Now, for the listeners, Mary Reiser is the head of Narconon in Georgia, and she was recently publicly condemned by a judge for lying along with Narconon in depositions. And in fact, there was a major ruling where she's going to, I guess, instruct a jury to disregard all of their testimony as false. And that kind of leads us to the next major player at Narconon Arrowhead, which is Gary Smith. And and Gary Smith has said things like, oh, well, we fire and turn over staff that do drugs. And yet they have this thing called restems, you know, where, or not restems, they have, I forget what they call it, but where a staff member, a repair, where if a staff member does drugs again, they get to go through the program again. And that is not the same thing as turning them over and having them be arrested. And I was wondering, what are some other blatant kind of lies you've heard Gary Smith make?
Well, some of them, for example, saying that you know, that they had that they were that they believe that they're fully in compliance with the law in the state of Oklahoma. They were absolutely scared, knowing that they were not any longer in compliance with the laws in the state of Oklahoma, which is what sparked, this was toward the end of my tenure there, what sparked a multi-year process of trying to work with the Oklahoma Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services again, because the law had changed where the health department no longer issued or no longer had any kind of oversight over treatment centers or rehabilitation facilities. And they were allowed to operate fully legally prior to that with a health department inspection and then their CAR for accreditation. Well, once the health department inspection no longer was valid because they had no jurisdiction anymore, they had to fall under some oversight of a state agency. And so they worked out this quasi-deal with the Oklahoma Department of Mental Health to only certify the non-medical detox portion of the program, which is the thing that's anywhere from 24 hours to, let's say, 10 days, depending on what somebody is withdrawing from. And that's it. So the entire rest of the program has no state oversight. And he knows that.
So, and we're going to get into this a little later about responsibilities and whatnot, but what you're saying right now is that the agency that should be shutting down or has the authority to shut down Narconon Arrowhead is the Department of Mental Health. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So as of right now, this is not CARF's responsibility, though they're responsible for their own behavior. Because I used to be under the impression that CARF had to be part of the process in order for them to operate. But what you're saying is that this falls solely under the venue or preview of the Department of Mental Health. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, that's all right. And I was going to say, and also whether or not, you know, they're still waiting to see if the district attorney is going to file any kind of criminal negligence charges based on one or more of the recent deaths there. And, you know, the attorney general's office or possibly through the district attorney's office could also issue, I believe, some sort of mandate. So that would be another state agency that could have some kind of jurisdiction of closing its doors if it came to that.
You had at one point said that you thought, I guess, Narconon shouldn't be closed but should be reformed. Is that still your position, or have you had, you know, what's your thoughts on it as you have kind of decompressed from it over time?
It's a continual decompression. You know, I've had so many conversations with different individuals about what a long process of untying and really examining things that were deeply inlaid, beliefs that were based on false ideas and things like that. You know, I've had this particular conversation with people too, including just from the mere fact that Narconon cannot operate within the framework of the law and be true to its own mandates. So because Narconon can only operate off of L. Ron Hubbard's policies, aside from some small legal aspect. So you can't have a psychiatrist on staff at a Narconon center because L. Ron Hubbard is adamantly opposed to psychiatry. But yet if a state requires some type of oversight from a psychiatrist or a medical doctor from that standpoint, then, you know, it clashes. So it cannot be in that manner. So basically that's a long way of saying, you know, I personally would not recommend that program to anybody.
Okay.
Frankly.
I'm wondering too, like I had heard Gary Smith talk about how addicts are liars and deceivers and they kind of, you have to expect that some of them are going to OD in a program. And I'm thinking to myself, these people went and got on a bus or on an airplane. They had their family pull their resources together. They're out there, they're doing their part. They're trying to get cured. I'm wondering what you think about that, what appears to me to be a completely callous attitude towards the loss of life or injury to persons.
Yeah. And, you know, Mary Reeser even said that in her interview. She said, you know, these aren't always the most truthful individuals. And, you know, and both of them in their own TV interviews had said something similar. And I think it's a cop-out, first of all, to it's almost shooting themselves in the foot by saying, okay, well, we don't work enough for people to be honest. Or to say, if they truly believe that they can help reform an individual, but yet not trust them, they can't have it both ways. So to then turn around and stab their own students in the back by saying that they're lying or they're untrustworthy in some manner, just goes to show that really, in the end, they're really only out for themselves and their long-term best interests of their group, and anything else is easily a casualty.
So somebody goes through the program, and they either complete the program or they don't. But the ones who do are often pressured to come to work for Narconon. I'd like to have you talk a little bit about the turnover rate, the type of pressure tactics that are put on people to work there. Tell me a little bit about that.
Sure. Yeah, it's that's a heavy thing, recruitment of people to join the staff or training programs. Different centers have slightly different variations of it, whether it be called an internship or if they're called a trainee. But usually they'll entice people to join a training program, and almost one for one, there's pressure put on them, requesting them to stay, telling them what a great group it is, what a great purpose. They owe it back to society to give back in some way. Really start with the guilt trips pretty heavily at that point. And if they make it through the training program, then they become a staff, or they have an opportunity to become a staff. And the turnover rate is so high, not only are they continuously recruiting, but let's say you have to hire 10 people to fill one position because the majority of them either relapse or quit and leave because they don't want to be there. And what you have left is a lot of lower level staff that continually turn over. And then you have higher level staff that have been there for years that are all Scientologists. And there's not much in between. There's a little bit of gray area, but not a whole lot.
I know that David Love has been doing some research into the labor abuse of people that work there and what is an intern, et cetera. And you and I had talked, and you said that in some cases, people can be interns up to a year. It's not always the case, but in some cases they can. And they work from 9 in the morning till 9 at night, 6 days a week. And often after, they wind up working for minimum wage. And I'm wondering, what type of quality of life does a person have on Narconon premises who lives like that?
Truthfully, they are, it's sort of like a commune in that everybody is dependent upon each other. And so, you go to eat in groups, you live in groups and clusters, whether they rent apartments or at Arrowhead, we had cabins. At Chilaco before that, they rented houses in town and stuffed as many people in there as possible. So you really are wholly dependent upon this group. And that becomes part of your mentality, is that you cannot survive without this group, and therefore you're willing to do anything and everything for it. And as that comes along, meanwhile, you're getting heavily indoctrinated, reading multiple policies and references from Hubbard, whether they were slightly altered to be what I would call narconized, and meaning they take the actual term of Scientology out of it and replace it with the word Narconon, but everything else is the same. Whether that happens or not, you're still being heavily indoctrinated, and over again, this is the only thing that works. We're the good people that saved your life. You owe us. And it just keeps on getting pounded in until you have a fully compliant slave of some sort. Even worse is that they don't know it. They don't think it. They believe that they're doing their part to salvage the world.
Well, and that's one of the questions I have, is why do people believe in Narconon so much? And, I said before, I wasn't trying to insult you, but you had the whole thing with the levitating ashtrays and the saunas and all of that. Why does that kind of thing not click with somebody and they go, oh my God, what am I involved in? Yet they become this like fanatical believer. What is it? What's the mindset? What does somebody got to do to fall into that?
It can be different for a lot of different people, but the biggest thing that I see, not only did I experience that, but I witnessed in many other people, is that what really draws you to it is the attraction of the other people that you can relate to, and that the activities or the study and the application of of their methods and materials becomes a secondary thing. What takes precedence is you now have this new camaraderie with other people that you develop strong bonds with because you were in a life-threatening situation, and now you're kind of coming out of it together, and there's a strong tie there. So it's more of wanting to be involved with them and then having this group agreement that, okay, we're going to also do something good along the way, than it is, I'm going to wear my Narconon pin and carry the Narconon banner for the rest of my life because Narconon is the reason for, you know, the world goes around. It eventually can become that, but it's not always that right away.
Yeah, and you had mentioned that a lot of the people that are there due to the camaraderie and things like that, or that even swear by the program, kind of ditch out on parts of the program. Like they don't always complete the sauna and things like that. Is that correct?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, a lot of the students, a lot of the clients, while they're going through there, they're running through the motions. You know, they share information of this is what you'd got to do to get through this part, and that's what you got to do, or here's how I made it through this part. Most of the people that go through there recognize that that much of it is such a joke that either they're not, taking all their vitamins or taking the full amount of niacin or exercising the same or sweating as much, or they're faking their training routines the best they can, or they're just writing down. They're starting to make up things that they have to write down when they write down their transgressions, what they call the Overton withhold. They're going through the motions. When they write their success stories, which we might talk about as well, is they know what they have to say and do to get to the next part because their goal is to be done.
So I just want to be clear that they do the overts and withholds. So they have these people confessing and writing their deepest, darkest secrets and sins and things like that, which the Church of Scientology has been notorious for using to silence people when they get out of line. Is that correct?
That is correct. You absolutely do a very thorough, as thorough as possible in that setting, write-up of your Overton withholds, just like you would at Church of Scientology. However, the only difference is they don't use an e-meter at Narconon, at least not for the students.
And at the same time, you can't finish the program until you write about how great it is and how it saved your life. Is that correct?
Exactly. Those are the success stories. Not only at the program ending. I mean, you're supposed to write this glowing success story at the end, but as you go through, as you complete each step, you're supposed to be writing success stories. And even in between, even through a minor achievement or accomplishment during one particular step, you're constantly encouraged to write success stories. And these Narconon centers are also essentially required to type these up and submit them to Narconon International so that they can be used in promotional materials. I saw, somebody had gotten a copy of a legislative briefing that was sent out to Oklahoma senators and representatives, for example, that had success stories from students in there. You know, and I'm reading those going, yeah, I remember what it's like to write those. Not only are you caught up in the moment, but you're also required to write them because otherwise they're going to look at you and go, he must not be done. He needs to do more.
And if you ever get out of line, they can show these documents, say, hey, I'm this worthless piece of filth that did all these horrible things, and this program saved my life. And that's what they would normally do in Scientology, but we have these patient-doctor privilege laws now that keep them from being able to get away with that, which is one of the reasons why I think the protest movement has been so successful here is because Scientology can't employ its normal attack tactics and get away with it. Is that, do you feel that there's some validation to that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of funny how it's called the HIPAA privacy laws, health information, privacy and portability or accountability act, something like that. And it winds up coming back to bite them because they're not allowed to divulge information. If they do, then they're subject to, I believe, a $20,000 fine per infraction, if I'm correct. I don't know about the exact amount, but so they're not allowed to. But yet, at the same time, for people that come in that are connected through the church in some manner, we were actually forced to divulge information on these clients or on these students up to people at the church, such as if somebody was referred through the Church of Scientology Celebrity Center, was connected to a celebrity Scientologist in some way. We actually had to give daily and weekly reports on their progress to Scientology members. And of course, the student, the client, never gave permission for that information to be divulged to anybody, let alone somebody at the church.
So that would be a direct violation of federal law.
Multiple.
I want to take a moment, and I want to kind of, there was something that was recently put up on the web, which was the 990s for Arrowhead and other locations. And one of the things that came out was, it looks like they're spending on average of $30 to $100 per staff member for training. To your knowledge, is that accurate? Is that close to being accurate?
Yeah, because most of the training that they do is only internal training. So staff members get credit based on how many Hubbard-related courses they have done, not outside training and continuing education. So, you know, certain like withdrawal students or with people who work in the withdrawal area, sure, they may have to take a CPR class. But, you know, you bring one instructor in, you can do 50 certifications for $250, let's say. So there's not really a whole lot of outside training that goes on for stuff. Most of it is simply internal training. If they work in one level, then they might do a course on the next level of the program or a next higher position on the organization chart for that center.
And this training really has nothing to do with actual drug rehabilitation. It has to do with so-called Hubbard life courses and things like that.
Exactly.
So essentially, when Narconon says these are highly trained drug detox specialists, there really is nothing there in the training program that really even familiarizes them with real drug detoxification.
True. Yeah, that's correct. It's based on, for example, their withdrawal is only about Hubbard's withdrawal information. Their detox, their sauna program is only from like Hubbard's Clear Body, Clear Mind. There's very little, if any, outside training that goes on. So they're highly trained is only an internal thing. It's all about image and PR, how they represent themselves to be legitimized in the public eye, such as using familiar terms or using psychological terms to describe themselves when they have zero connection to such a thing.
Okay, I'm going to take a quick break, ladies and gentlemen, for 30 seconds. We're going to do a PSA, and then we're going to be right back with Lucas Kent, so hang tight.
Campaign in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
This is Radio Paul at Radio Fairfax, and I'm on the line tonight with Lucas Canton, former president of Narconon Arrowhead, Scientology Front Group. Lucas, let's talk about the political schmoozing that was going on while you were at Arrowhead. What are some of the things you saw that would make you worried as a citizen that maybe your government, state government, had some questionable dealings or individuals in the government?
Well, looking back on it today, there were many things that at the time I thought was cool because I was a part of that movement. But really looking at it from, like you're saying, from the side of a citizen or somebody else outside that would be concerned about activities include, you know, we took a trip to Washington, D.C., for example. And back then it was Clark Carr, who's the president of Narconon International, Rena Weinberg, who was the president of Able International, who's been locked up at Scientology's international base for about 6 years now, and Erica Christensen, the actress who at the time was part of Traffic, you know, the movie Traffic, where it was nominated for an Academy Award, I believe. And so she was invited to be part of the Drug Czar's Advisory Committee for Demand Reduction, which is a fancy word for drug education. And so because she was personally invited, because she had that role in the film, we all went out, including one of the vice presidents from Scientology Celebrity Center, and we all went out and tried to set up meetings using her as an angle to get in and gain favor with people in the DEA, people at Center for Substance Abuse Treatment, people at Center for Substance Abuse Prevention, various senators and representatives. And the same thing, in different manners, were used in Oklahoma directly, which is how can we find any kind of favor with these people and use that to our advantage, either to affect legislation on our behalf or to gain some other favor to either possibly look the other way on something or gain an endorsement of some type that we can then flash on our website or parade around to other officials and say, look, your boss gave us his signature, so we must be okay.
And I understand that you are aware of an individual by the name of Connie Johnson, who is a state senator, and there was some dealings with her that gave you some pause for real concern. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, when I was still president, then we had begun doing some different legislative activities over in Oklahoma City, and one of the things that came up was Connie Johnson was an aide to a senator previous to then, and she had said, "Look, you know, I know somebody who needs some help. Is there anything you can do?" So Gary Smith and his wife specifically took it on as a project to bring this person into the program at no charge and put this person through the program, through the entire thing, free of charge, as a favor to this person who we knew worked for a senator before she was elected to her own Senate seat. And then after that, recruited her to be a staff member and positioned her in my office. Like, didn't even have any say so in it. It was like, this person is going to work in your office because of her connections. She's going to be one of your assistants, whether I wanted it or not, didn't matter. And later on, Connie Johnson runs for and becomes elected to the Oklahoma Senate herself. And so it winds up being that, okay, now you have somebody in an official capacity who you've done a favor for, who you're going to expect a favor from later on down the road.
And she was also instrumental in trying to push through. She was a co-sponsor of a bill that Narconon wanted to go through?
That's correct. There was at least a draft of a bill that was located that she was a co-sponsor or co-author of. And and that's a perfect example of why. I was gone, at least from the position of president at that time, that it came in. So I didn't have the exact details of how that particular thing came out. But yeah, that's an example. You know, a year or two later, all of a sudden you have a bill that comes up that's in favor of Narconon Arrowhead without naming them specifically, that's going to affect the laws governing treatment centers in the state. And sure enough, she's a co-author of it.
Narconon goes to great lengths and does a very poor job, I might mention, to say it is secular and does not have any direct connection to the Church of Scientology. Why is Narconon Scientology? What makes it Scientology?
First of all, the courses themselves, the books that are in the Narconon program are all books that are found in a Church of Scientology. It's a different cover. It may be presented in a slightly different manner, but it is some of them, or most of them, even have the exact same titles. The training routines, the TRs that are done in Narconon, they're the same TRs used at a Church of Scientology that are used to train Scientology auditors that everybody goes through when they become a Scientologist. The purification rundown at a church is the exact same thing that the sauna detox program at a Narconon. Other books include the basic study manual, or the learning improvement course, depending on which way you look at it, or the objectives auditing. Objectives are auditing sessions that are done at a church and at a Narconon both. The ups and downs in life course, the changing conditions in life course, the personal values and integrity course, the way to happiness course, all those courses that are offered at Narconon are offered at churches as well.
I understand too, when people complete the Narconon course, they want them to do follow-up courses that are only held at Scientology buildings. Is that true, or is there something similar to that?
It's often recommended, yeah. It's never – they're careful because of so much pressure and so many – especially in the last 10 years of the internet, there's been so much more exposure about it that they have been less pushy about it. So it really depends on the center and the situation. But yeah, there's many times where somebody will say, hey, I need to figure out something else I need to do. I say, well, you know, you have a Church of Scientology close to you. If you want to continue to study this material in more detail, then that's something that you can do there. It really depends on the situation and the staff and that kind of thing.
I was looking online and somebody had put up a general agreement between a Narconon Center and Narconon International. And this document basically lays out payments to be made. It lays out the authority that Narconon International has over the center. And one of the things I saw that was really interesting was there was a lot of language in it as to how you won't disparage the name of L. Ron Hubbard. You know, you'll use his name in a certain way. But it was completely absent of any discussion about patients' rights or the care of people. And I was wondering, throughout the documents that Narconon centers have and sign on a daily basis, is there really a focus on the physical well-being, or is there a lack of focus on the physical well-being of the individuals there?
Well, it's clearly a lack of focus. I mean, first of all, from Narconon International standpoint, their main marching orders are get money and spread the word to increase the PR image of L. Ron Hubbard. Those are the two primary purposes, so that somebody can be sought after to bring into the church at that point. Because any activity that is connected to Scientology and whatsoever, its ultimate goal as a part of that group is to, I mean, their stated purpose is to, quote unquote, clear the planet, to get them up to a certain point on their bridge to total freedom and then beyond. So every activity is with the goal of converting every single person to become a Scientologist. And that is their stated purpose, and they're pretty clear about that. So to claim that they are involved in something for some other reason completely contradicts what their stated purpose is, first of all. But not only that, when you come down to the Narconon centers, if a Narconon center is going to be more compliant than another one, that's kind of up to them. Narconon International doesn't wind up enforcing enough of compliance with state laws because they're more concerned with the image and how you're representing their trademarks and how you're representing L. Ron Hubbard. And you better not alter the program because it's not allowed. So you can't be in compliance with the state laws if it goes against what our program says it's supposed to be.
Yeah, it was very clear from that very basic entry-level document that what you're saying is right on the money. I want you to take a moment and talk about what happens when the slop hits the fan, you know, that there's been a death, there's a PR nightmare. Who gets involved in that? Who's in control, and what happens?
Ultimately, where it winds up, not even ultimately, pretty much initially, is calls get made to and from OSA, which is Office of Special Affairs for Church of Scientology. Narconon centers have directors of legal affairs, which is an OSA-related position. In fact, OSA usually has to give clearance or approval to post somebody as a director of legal affairs, straight up through Narconon International and then Able International and the church, etc. So they have this entire network of legal and governmental affairs that as soon as there's some kind of major thing like that happens, immediately OSA is on the line. And not only are they giving directions, but they want information. They want to know exact details of what's happening. Has it hit the media yet? Has it hit online yet? Who knows? Who doesn't know? What are you doing? Have you contacted the family? And they start barking orders left and right. And it came to the point where I think even in, for example, the Patrick Desmond case, not only did they hide documents, which were clearly known to exist by anybody who had any previous involvement to it, but they had even alluded to that they later found out, leading to the sanctions you mentioned, that Mary Reeser reported directly to the director of legal affairs special affairs at the church in Atlanta and the Office of Special Affairs of Church International. And so that is exactly what protocol is you have to notify the church when there's such a major problem like that and the church is involved from the get-go.
And of course, and let's just be clear here, this is an organization that says that they're their own secular thing and they don't answer to the Church of Scientology, yet they're taking their marching orders from the intelligence wing of the Church of Scientology. And I just want to be clear, Narconon's not paying these people as advisors. These are people that are picking up the phone and have the authority just to tell and bully around people at Narconon. Is that correct?
That is correct. That's exactly correct. All right. And that's why, for example, even when they knew that there was a problem with the housing at the Georgia facility and they even ordered her, first of all, to not get rid of their housing that they had then. And it unfortunately wound up in a very unnecessary death.
So there's
and then later,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I'll say, and then later on, then trying to cover it up, and now you wind up with Mary Reeser, who's going to wind up being the scapegoat, and she absolutely has culpability. However, she is by no means the only one responsible.
And she does not have permission to refuse to follow OSA's directives. Is that correct? She can't say, well, I don't work for you, I'm not going to follow this, because what would happen to her if she did?
She'd be ripped off post immediately and sent to what they do, they call a sec check, security check, where they're put on a meter and start looking for her crimes. If you defy orders from OSA, then you automatically are assumed to have committed some type of crime or done something, what they call out ethics.
So a organization that claims it's secular can be retaliated against by the Church of Scientology. There are consequences for refusing the Church of Scientology's orders.
Fully, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And not just in the legal affairs or executive directors. There's other executive positions that wind up in that capacity as well. When I requested to no longer be the president of Arrowhead because of all the internal conflict that was going on, I wound up sitting in Los Angeles, bouncing around between Able International, Narconon International, Church of Scientology, Celebrity Center, and American Saint Hill Organization, which is another church organization, being handled as essentially a Scientology staff member, not as a Narconon staff member. Because, yes, at the time I was an individual Scientologist, but that's I wasn't there as an individual Scientologist. I was sent there to be handled by the Church of Scientology.
We only have about 8 minutes left in the show, and I've got a whole list of pain and suffering you've been through and a whole list of pain and suffering people at Narconon as patients have been through. And I'd like to just kind of quickly talk about what's happened to you within about 2 minutes. What's been done to you for speaking out?
Even before speaking out, I mean, first of all, when I started, for example, commenting on things anonymously through different message boards or blogs and that kind of stuff, I came clean. I told them everything that I did. I showed them everything, and I tried to believe that they were going to be good. Wound up being totally used against me, and obviously I'm no longer married. As a result of that, I lost about 90% of the people that I had in my life for the past 10, 12 years because they're ordered literally overnight. They're ordered to cease all communication because they issue what's called a suppressive person declare. So they said, because I refused to go along with their cover up, because I had found out what I had found out and wasn't willing to recant, then they wanted to cut me out like a cyst. But I wasn't a cyst. I was actually a beacon of light of exposing these things, such as what you're doing and such as what so many other people out there are doing to expose that. And they have to clamp on so tightly to the people that they have left, because they are leaving in droves, that they become extremely ruthless in making sure that you don't infect others with truth. And it's a hard thing to endure.
Well, I agree you're a beacon of light, but if nothing else, you're a person, and the way that they treat people is not the way you should treat any person, regardless of who they are. And one of the things, of all the different things, I don't know, we got a ton of time to get into them, but one of the things we had talked about was Book 5 teaches mm-hmm. people to disconnect from friends and family if they start to question the person's Narconon belief. So if your dad calls up and go, they taught you what in there? You got to be joking me. They're having you try to talk to ashtrays. They start using part of the course to pressure you to disconnect from your loved ones. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, that's exactly what happens. I mean, when they start to identify anybody who might say something negative about L. Ron Hubbard or about Narconon or about Scientology, they say that those are the people who are dangerous and you have to watch out for, and they don't have your well-being at heart. So they say you have to either handle them or disconnect. And if somebody isn't willing to let it go, then they are told, even at Narconon centers, well, you should probably disconnect from this person because they're detrimental to your sobriety. And so disconnection is used within Narconon as well, to where people are taught that their parents and other loved ones could be the reason for their, not only the reason for their addiction to begin with, but also that they could be a cause for them to relapse if they stay connected to them.
And they also do things like monitor phone calls and things of that nature. They really are in control of what the person hears and sees in the world. Is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Whether they're within an earshot distance or whether they have people that are hanging around telephone banks. I mean, at Arrowhead, there were telephones down near the student lounge, for example, and somebody usually would have to do something called night watch, where they would actually literally rove around the whole building, but then there would be usually somebody down near the phones listening to the conversations and either hanging up phones or reporting them the next day, or if they made phone calls at program support services, they were within earshot. So it's very much a controlled environment to the most that they can. They don't want information coming in or out. And I guarantee with the five current lawsuits at Narconon of Oklahoma, they are extremely paranoid that anything negative gets entered into the program. So they're monitoring it even more now, I'm sure.
And just for the record, these people that go to Narconon, they think they're going to a real detox, a secular detox. They don't know what they're getting involved in. Is that correct?
Yeah, they're not being told honestly what the program is. They might be sent some information via email, or they might fax something to them, and they might hear that it's based on Owen Hubbard or see it on a page here or there or something. But no, they're really told way different things about what actually happens. Like when you start talking about TRs and training routines, when you're sitting there in front of another person for 2 hours staring at one another, or you're talking about do birds fly and do fish swim and reading out of Alice in Wonderland, they don't tell you about any of that stuff. They're like, oh, we help you increase your communication. And they think, hey, that's a pretty good thing. I could increase my communication. They don't realize what they're about to get into.
Yeah. What would you say is the reason you don't think that the state of Oklahoma has broken a foot off in Narconon's rear end? It sounds like with all these deaths and injuries and having the authority to do it, why are they not acting?
I think it's two-part, frankly. I think one of them is that they're using the tactics that I told you about, trying to find leverage over different decision makers and policy makers, and whether they can call in favors here or there or use any kind of leverage they can to either buy them time or something. That's one tactic being used. But on top of that, the state very clearly remembers the fight that they had with Scientology over the certification of Shalako back in 1991 and the major lawsuit that occurred then. And they are afraid, because they know that if they deny certification and order Arrowhead shut down, that the Church of Scientology is going to bring its high-powered lawyers back into the state and try and ruin the state. Not try and do the right thing and take responsibility for the deaths that they have caused, but instead they're going to try and bankrupt a state by taking them through years and years of litigation just because they feel like it. That's why they're afraid.
Yeah, because they lost the last time. Oklahoma won and shut them down, and they went and did that CARF thing. But it sounds like, yeah, because this has the potential to severely damage Scientology if it gets shut down. It will be a real game changer. Is that correct?
Absolutely. They have so much at stake with Arrowhead. It's ridiculous. Not only has it brought in probably $100 million in donations to the IAS, the International Association of Scientologists, not only has it brought in that much money because it's an IAS-sponsored facility. In other words, Narconon doesn't own that property. It's owned by a church property holding company. And so they use that as this PR puff piece and as part of their propaganda. It's so valuable to them. It represents what Narconon is. It represents L. Ron Hubbard drug rehabilitation. It represents so much and so much money that they're not going to go down without a heavy fight unless you have, like, if the DA's office files criminal charges on criminal neglect, then they're going to have much more leg to stand on as far as a reason to shut them down. Other than that, the lawsuits themselves certainly are probably going to be on their way through Gary Richardson and his team to bankrupt the organization there.
You know, we still have the issue of drug addicts, and these people are in pain and they're in need. And I was wondering if in a minute you could talk about what you think drug addicts really need to do, what type of real help they can reach out for.
That's a good question. And it's come up a few times too with different attorneys and different message boards. It's tough. The drug rehab landscape is so wide and varied that the best advice that I can give for somebody is to examine multiple options. You can go on, for example, right now, you can go on treatment.samhsa, which is SAMHSA.gov. And you can search your local area and you can find every listing of program within 50 miles, both inpatient and outpatient, and talk to them. Find out what they really do. If you can, go visit the place before you commit to anything. Find out what other types of certifications and state requirements they have, and see what really feels right. Because one of the things that Narconon has going for it is that so many people come from out of state. They get on a plane and they're basing it off of a phone conversation and a website. And without being able to inspect that before you give them any kind of money or before they run your insurance or anything, get the feeling, meet the people, see what they do, get their credentials. And if it feels right at that point, then move forward.
Well, I have to say, Lucas, I think you're an extremely brave person. I know you have laid a lot on the line. I know that you've already suffered consequences. I know you're going through a process of decompressing and learning, and that, you know, that's a process that people go through, and I want to personally extend my thanks to you. Listeners, next week we're also going to be talking about persecuted people, but next week it's going to be atheists in the United States who have been persecuted. So I want you to tune in for Radio Paul's Radio Rants next week. We're going to have some folks here in the studio and some online and some of the horror stories that they have gone through. Stick around next for Canadian Accents, where we're going to have some great music, Canadian style. Lucas Catton, thank you for being a guest on Radio Paul's Radio Rants.
Thank you so much, Paul. I appreciate it.
Good night.
All right.